Today, there's another duo that's here, and they look like they're going to sit down with two mics right here. On the right is Peter Van Wyck and Julie Salverson on the left. I don't know why I had to say right and left. Should be obvious. Have a little more light on them. And they have collaborated on projects for some time. They've traveled. Can you all hear me up here? They've traveled up to Port Radium together along the Atomic Highway. They have just recently come back, or in April, they were giving lectures and doing interviews and doing research in Japan and Hiroshima, Fukushima, Tokyo, and elsewhere. And I think we're going to hear something about that work here. And they both have very distinguished careers in very different areas. So Julie is a superb dramatist and a librettist for the opera Shelter. Some of you may have seen that here, both played here and in Edmonton a year ago. And Peter is the author of three books and many articles, the most recent one called The Highway of the Atom. It's terrific to have you both here. Thank you.
You can hear me? Yes? Okay. All right. G.
Okay, we got this.
All right. I can't believe I said G in this circle of people. So, G. Thank you very much for having us. I want to echo the thank yous to John and Claudette for the endlessly gracious hospitality of this gathering. We are going to read without images. We thought we would see what happens when we do that. Without further ado.
So the title of our paper is Through the Lens of Fukushima. The wind leaves little traces behind, shadows, ruins, and a little bit of waste from which to make things.
One, opening. We are here 70 years after Hiroshima and Nagasaki, 70 years after the liberation of Auschwitz, 67 years after the Canadian government began extracting uranium from a mine on Aboriginal land, 78 years after Nanjing, 4 years after Fukushima. I am, you are, by cowardice or courage, the one who finds a way back to a scene, writes an American poet, Adrian Rich. The act of mourning is a ritual of digging. It is not new to say that the world is going to hell in a handbasket. The phrase comes from the 17th century. It means to deteriorate rapidly. What is new is not the idea of disaster as something that ends life. What is new is the end of the idea of life, the end of striving, dreaming, imagining, renewing. James left up yesterday with a structural existential threat. And also he said, I am blown away that we got through the 20th century without being blown away, but perhaps we didn't. Jean-Luc Nancy, who's been quoted already this morning, says we live no longer in tragic meaning. We are being exposed to a catastrophe of meaning. Let's not hurry to hide this exposure. Let us remain exposed. Let us think about what is happening to us. March 31st, 2015. Sitting in the departure lounge beside my friend who I have traveled with before, but not like this. In 2002, we flew north to Delaunay, home of the El Dorado uranium mine and the beginning of Canada's atomic adventures. Port Radium, where old black and white photographs blur the distance between Aboriginal European romance and exploitation, history and hysteria. Peter and I flew in our nascent innocence to try to make real an archive and an anxiety. One placing his years of reading into the architecture of his own first contact, the other confronting a shyness she had turned into a scholarly explanation for hiding. Somewhere over the Pacific, we change the time on our cell phones to Japan. We slip through time zones and glance off the day and the night and the day again. My husband was nervous about me going to Fukushima. Be careful, he said, when he dropped me at the airport. I would rather you just read about it, he said, from here. But where in the world is here? Here, says Catherine Malibu, is a planet that hurts. Impoverishment and emotional coolness are the new battlefield. The world is too full of pain. In 2015, living in these perpetual afters, we are the new wounded, she says, suffering a paralysis of touching. The impossibility of feeling anything blurs the mirror that connects us to ourselves and others. Touch, exposure, contact, slippery words. Susceptibility to disease, contamination, colonial conquest, availability to learning, love, adventure. Which definitions give us more protection, more possibility? When Peter and I first wrote about our trip to Delaunay, we called ourselves bewildered strangers. We were a courteous, respectful pair. Not a bad thing, but there are many ways to hide, many ways to keep your feet from touching the ground.
2, field note, the ground, April 2015. What are we doing in Japan? I suppose that part of the answer is simply that we needed to come here to try and understand the strange kinship and connection between the military atom and the civilian atom. What is it that holds these practices together? 2 unstable proper names, Hiroshima, Fukushima. A vexatious rhyme, as Nancy puts it, laying bare perhaps a parochial European ear, but linking together, that is, hearing the strong and deep line, the root, in other words, that holds these things together. It's not possible, he writes, to ignore what is suggested by the rhyme of these two names, for rhyme gathers together, reluctantly against all poetry, the ferment of something shared. It is this something shared that brought us here, the ferment, the reluctance, the complex connection between uranium mined in the far north of Canada, another moment in a long series of Aboriginal erasures in Canada's project of national self-realization, and the development of the bomb, its use at Alamogordo and then Japan in 1945, and the events of March 2011. But also, we are here because we want to write so that we can understand why it is that we have come. Writing is like that. We are here doing an exercise in field topistics. Topistics, a descriptive mode of proximity, an intensification of reading and writing, feeling and thinking in a particular locale or place. It's a concept proposed by E.V. Walter, derived from the Greek word topos, for the study of what he called placeways. And by way of explanation, he tells us a story that locates us as well. Thales, one of the 7 sages, while observing the stars, fell into a well. A Thracian slave woman laughed at him, saying he wanted to know what was happening in the heavens, but failed to observe what was in front of his own feet. In this simple way, she exposed the predicament of a theorist who loses his ground. Topistics, said Walter, was also aligned with the archaic sense of the word theoria, which meant seeing the sights, seeing for yourself, getting a worldview, becoming exposed. The first theorists were tourists. Their writing arose from the ground. Where else to become exposed?
3, visiting. The visitor does not knock, writes Levinas, but interrupts through a kind of burglary. Is it possible to prepare for this abrupt encounter, this invested relationship, with no assurance except the possibility of receiving from the world something different? In a letter to Gershom Scholem about Kafka, Walter Benjamin wrote this. He said, this much Kafka was absolutely sure of. First, that someone must be a fool if he is to help. Second, that only a fool's help is real help. The only uncertain thing is, can such help do a human being any good? And then, there is an infinite amount of hope, but not for us. Well, this suggests risk, engagement, failure. The context is the inevitable pain of ongoing loss in the midst of an almost ridiculous insistence upon life and a hope that is different from a messianic hope that doesn't offer reassurance or certainties, a fool's help, a visiting that performs otherwise. In 2002, Peter called to tell me that much of the uranium used in the atomic bombs dropped on Japan had come from a mine in northern Canada. He called me because for most of my adult life, I have worked with survivors of trauma and written about it and made plays about it. What he didn't know was, I didn't want to do this anymore. Years of it had made me sick, and I'd had enough, I thought. But the invitation was intriguing. Did I want to accompany him along the highway of the atom? The event became a proposition. Could we be neither paralyzed nor tragic, but foolish witnesses? looking for not explanation, not explication, but hexaetas, thisness. So as I listened on my end of the phone, Peter said it wasn't until the late 1990s that the Dene had really confirmed the link between their land and Hiroshima. And then they did this extraordinary thing. This thing that we have spent the last 13 years trying not to understand, but to receive. 57 years after Hiroshima was bombed, a delegation of Satu Dene from Delaunay, Canada, traveled to Japan to make an apology. Their trip was the result of a long and careful process. They talked, they listened, they consulted. The elders were with them. This was not an individual act. They went to send their respect. They went because the beginning was meeting the end.
Four, shadows and light. Like the Dene, whose retroactive knowledge reconfigured their past, the Japanese too had no clear idea of what had taken place. In the weeks following August 6 and 9, Japanese military engineers, struggling to understand, knew neither where the detonation was focused nor what kind of weapon had been deployed. To the former, they were able to estimate the location of the bomb's hypocenter by triangulating so-called atomic shadows left within its footprint. Infinitely melancholic shadows, ever adrift, abandoned by their objects. As the media of exposure, with bodies and objects dodged on sidewalks and walls, the cities were rendered photographic. They became forensic sundials for the geolocation and symbolic reconstruction of the flash of the detonation. We know that photography was intimately connected with the unstable atom long before Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Photography, the scandalous medium, was there from the start. We also know that the photographic flash left photography changed. No longer the pencil of nature inscribing a moment lifted from the idle passage of time. It was an intervention through the manufacture of light that would wrench the object into visibility. Capture versus cause. The flash reconfigured the shutter-filled relation. But these shadows, these atomic shadows, reactivate another line of derivation, this one also to do with the flash of light. Long before photography discovered the flash had discovered photography. For quite some time, with reports dating back to the first century, but of particular interest in the 19th century, lightning was said to have had the capacity to produce images, to record the exact details of exposure on receptive surfaces, both bodies and walls. Carinography came to be called lightning writing, images, a tree and its branches, the likeness of an adjacent body, a perfectly engraved image of a church. In 1871, Fauvier noted in his treatise, Thunder and Lightning, accounts published in certain journals before the discovery of Daguerre mention a strange phenomenon which might have suggested the wonderful invention of photography. Witnesses who appear worthy of confidence have seen the shadow of an individual fixed spontaneously upon a wall. As reported in the Canadian Photographer in 1900, J.P. Sullivan, Salina, Kansas, has a horse in whose right eye there is a photograph of his wife. It is as though the rise and popular uptake of photographic technologies and practice in the 19th century, the Daguerrean moment, nurtured a forensic optical unconscious with a surplus of an imaginative explanatory trait. It is odd, though, that no one appears to have remarked on this strange carinographic echo in 1945. Today, carinographic marks, sometimes called lightning flowers or lightning trees, are said to be caused by relativistic electrons in the skin, no mention of sidewalks and walls. And as to what manner of bomb had been dropped, the Japanese too developed film, X-ray film, and found only shadows.
Five, wine, not radiation. We travel with a Japanese friend who translates and organizes, well, everything. Aya is from Hiroshima, and she grew up plagued with terrifying images and the insistence on the part of her elders that she make the world better. I give a resilience workshop for peace educators in Hiroshima. Many are the children or grandchildren of victims or survivors and are driven to account for their own existence. I called Aya a few months before our trip. I said, I want to see more than victims. I want to see the beauty of the place. I want to meet the teacher who's more interested in wine than radiation. That's good, she said. Everyone comes for the trauma. On the train, an hour from Fukushima, Aya gives Peter and I a safety briefing. There's the outside and the inside, like everything in Japan, but it is dangerous there because alpha particles can be on the floor, the street, the ground. TEPCO workers are all over, including near the plant, and they stay at our hotel. So their boots will be in the hall, maybe on the carpets in the room, so the outside shoes stay outside. Inside, never let your bare feet or even your socks touch the floor because you never know, it only takes one particle. Peter pulls out a map that charts daily radiation levels. These are made by Safecast, a sensor network created by citizens who decided to find the information they needed themselves. Aya says everyone agrees there will be another big earthquake and another tsunami eventually. She always carries two bottles of water, she says, and a chocolate bar and a flashlight, enough for 2 days. I get up, I go down the train corridor, I find the woman with the cart, and I buy two bottles of water, and I bring them back to our seats, and I give one to Peter. Mount Fuji water. Mount Fuji Springs. It's really good, that water, says Aya. At the bottom of the escalator in Fukushima, the train station, there are massive posters of cherry blossoms, statues from local festivals, and an alternate energy display, all bright colors and smiles. I count 11 people working in a tiny tourism office, the most important job in town, Peter says. We walk to our hotel. The streets are lively and occupied. We pass a man with a dog. I think that dog's feet are on the ground all the time. What does that mean for the dog? What does that mean for the man's house? When we get to the hotel, I read an email from my husband. He's gotten sick. Maybe the flu, he writes. Should have gotten a flu shot, he asks. Flu shot? I realize I'm thinking in very different terms about everything. People who live here just forget about it, says Aya. I say something about how, well, we're only here for a few days. Well, no, she says, a few days, that's not less. We're really playing Russian roulette, she says. Again, I really wish she would stop saying this. At the corner, the 7-Eleven, there's lots of alcohol, a lot more than there was in the same store in Hiroshima. How interesting. Hiroshima is now the safe place.
Six trees. In response to the fireball, the force and heat of the blast, and the immediate and massive dose of neutron and gamma radiation, virtually all of the vegetation within the 1.5 kilometer blast radius in Hiroshima was incinerated immediately. Many of the trees not killed instantly were subsequently consumed by fire. Those that survived, many badly damaged, partly uprooted, scorched, scarred, came to be called the Hibaku trees, Hibaku Jumoku, survivor trees, empirical falsifications of the Hiroshima myth that nothing would grow for 70 years. Many of these Hibaku trees continued to grow, but in a curious way, the damaged side of the tree, the side facing the blast, was no longer capable of growing at the same rate as the opposite side. So gradually these trees began to lean, and as they grew, they began to point toward the site of the detonation, growing and pointing toward the hypocenter. More than silent witnesses to the destructive power of atomic visibility, these trees point to the scene of the event there, it happened over there. More than leafy witnesses to the past of events, they are active, they witness. The people in Hiroshima who take care of these trees tell me that over the years and for various reasons, a number of them have been moved to other locations. When this has happened, their original orientation with respect to the hypocenter was not registered or respected. They were just replanted. I was shocked to learn this. This is not like spinning a sunflower away from the sun in order to see its slow heliotropic response. This is different. This is to realign the very posture of the witness. It is to turn away from the event, something these trees, unlike much of Japan, were otherwise incapable of doing. Exactly, in other words, what Hiroshima wishes not to do in its efforts to become the atomic Geneva of Asia. There are today some
170 official tobacco trees in Hiroshima, each identified and cared for under the guidance of a master gardener. "You must be careful," he told me. "You must not help the trees too much. You must understand their capabilities and help them achieve the health and growth for which they are capable."
Seven, trees. Tokyo is trying to get it together before the 2020 Olympics. National and local governments and countless businesses are inviting the world to come to Japan, a country proud of its hospitality. They want the disaster to go away. But many residents in the affected areas don't trust their governments, and they don't trust the Fukushima Electric Company, whose cost-cutting decisions maintaining the plant, oh, interesting. Maintaining the plant, make many people say that March 11th was an act of negligence. As more Japanese face TEPCO's evasions and what is perceived as the betrayal of the national government, a seismic shift is happening in the country. This shift from trusting authority to trusting each other is led by Fukushima and Iwate prefectures. There's a saying in Japan, when you need support, you lean on the biggest tree. Riku Zentakata, a small city among the hardest hit on the coast, is rebuilding itself with bulldozers and the faith of its citizens. The symbol of that faith is the story of a single tree. When the tsunami destroyed 70,000 white pines that lined the city's famous beach, it left one survivor. The city spent a fortune flushing the salt water from the tree's roots, but within a year it had died. The tree has been preserved as a memorial, and seedlings from the miracle tree of hope are growing at the Tsukuba Research Institute. At a gas station, Peter and I and Aya get directions. "It's stuffed like you would do with an animal," says the attendant. We make our way down a carefully marked pathway that winds its way through the construction site that has replaced the city's waterfront. A bird's nest rests in the branches, and a young Japanese couple leave a bouquet wrapped in cellophane at the base. Among the souvenirs sold to raise money for the local volunteers center is a t-shirt with a picture of the Tree of Hope and the words, "Keep on fighting." We drive to a small fishing village and spend the night. I wake up early and I walk along the harbor. There's a small rebuilt wooden shrine. It is for safety for the boats at sea. I can't seem to stop watching the water, how it moves. Suddenly the quiet is broken by a loud announcement. I find out later it says, "Good morning, everyone, it is morning." A kind of a get ready for the day announcement, and the music is "Love is Blue," which Aya then says is a French song. We hear that they also broadcast in the evening. "It's evening, everyone, get ready."
Eight, field notes, Camera Atomica, August 2015, Toronto. When we returned from Japan, everything, ourselves included, has changed. We struggle to turn from the east, to disorient ourselves. Japan has just waited a barely discreet 2 days after the commemorative events of the 70th anniversary to flip the on switch at the Sendai nuclear station, bringing back into operation the first of its now 43 operable reactors, stations dark since that Friday in March when the ground lurched into motion and the ocean rose up. Even the name of this event has shifted in our absence, transforming the very nature of our sight and our seeing from atomic eyes to post-atomic eyes. Just how many afters can we endure?
Peter and I head to Toronto to view the exhibit. I stand at the entrance, mesmerized by the disturbing beauty of the chandelier. Directly across the room, a child runs across a narrow passageway. A moment of life, the children's play area interrupts the suspended preoccupations of adults. I move on through the cold quiet, soft murmurs of visitors leaning in, pulling back. I spend about an hour slowly absorbing. Standing in front of one of Carol Gallagher's panels of texts, I stop breathing. I turn, I look around, and I think, what do we do now? What do we do with all this? When Peter had called me in 2002 and invited me on this atomic adventure, I had gotten sick. I had become an unreliable witness. I only listened for the pain. My doctor, hearing about my work with trauma, advised me, next time, why don't you research paradise? As I stumble out past the last photographs, Takeda's nebulous of waiting, I am stopped by the title of the next exhibit, Where is Paradise on Earth?
The wind will blow the fire of pain across everyone in time. That's how Robert Frank figured it. Maybe such a profusion of images, exposures of expansive exposure, all in a way testimony to what we could think of as the spatial annexation of time. We are all exposed in the gallery and elsewhere. Archival, documentary, conceptual, some so real and achingly sublime as to merit curatorial instruction to visit proper landscape painting on the floor above.
We return the next day. I move more slowly, examine the photographs more closely, the rooms, the visitors. Pain collides and colludes with elegance, echoes of Adorno, the forbidden and the necessary job of art. There's a kind of cool remove in these rooms. Glimpses of historical location, are they teases or trauma fragments? Is the emotional coolness ahistorical or inviting? Performing perhaps an affect of power found in the gaps between images, a place of what Julie Burrell calls productive collusions, activating, quote, a network of references and comparisons in the audience's minds, unquote, not telling us how to think and feel, but pointing to history and, quote, hurt by showing what was, unquote. Does this invite response, ask us to take responsibility, look further, ask questions, refusing empathic identifications, easy narratives, or does it float us timeless and placeless? And which gives us more protection and which more possibility?
From Brisner's instantaneous technical impossibilities to Matsushige's scenes of bloodless horror to Del Tredici's uncanny matter-of-factness and Carol Gallagher's painful ethnophotography, all of these moments of exposure borne by images and a poverty of text presented here as a genre, a politico-aesthetic genre, and still we sit, still here, in the second most nuclearized precinct on the planet, still here, in the second atomic age. The images at the outset are archival and documentary, except for Isiuchi Miyako's haunting dress. They are all secured in a kind of melancholic pastness that has been. Henry Busey is there. As we walk into the third room, I recognize his image of miners at Port Radium at Great Bear Lake from the archive in Yellowknife. He took hundreds of photos there and was part of the Port Radium Photography Club. He might have started it, I can't remember. And closer still to where we sit today, the uranium processing plant at Port Hope is there too, as a kind of via negativa, a catalog of absence. How can we locate the Dene here? Where are they? I ask this not as a curatorial question, not exactly, but as a matter of narrative, as a matter of justice. They were there too, at the beginning and before the beginning. As they tell it, they were the ones who told the white miners where to look for the money rock, as it was called. But more to the point, the whole Canadian story comes to light to begin with only as a result of their retroactive realization of what it was that they had been involved with. Delaname, the village of widows, the apology. As scholars, we have worked for many years trying to bring to light the archival silence and the proxy archives of erasure beneath Canada's involvement in the bomb's development, to hear and record the stories and testimony of a First Nation, one among many, who have materially and symbolically suffered the ongoing effects of their atomic exposure.
9. Stories change the brain. How can we locate the Dene here? It's not a simple question. When I first visited Delaney, I was paralyzed by how little I knew as a white woman from Southern Ontario. And I planned to write mainly about Port Hope because I grew up pretty much next door. But I really knew nothing about Port Hope either. Not really. In Delaney, people said, "We've been left out of the story." I realized my fear of doing the same thing made me almost continue that erasure. Chickasaw scholar Jody Bird mobilizes a word that calls up the complication of how to adequately represent the ramifications of Aboriginal dispossession. Agnosia, from Brain Science. Quote, "the loss or diminution of the ability to recognize familiar objects," unquote. So Bird calls our incapacity to interpret colonial agnosia. New work in brain science and brain plasticity tells us that stories change the brain. We become the narratives we create. When I first went to Delaney, for example, all I could see was the sorrow of the place, cancer, political betrayal. When I returned 10 years later, I saw more. I heard about arguments, love affairs, babies born, wildflowers, jealousies, teenagers exploding in joy and anger, old people teaching, old people hiding away. I was able to see life. The sound of a plane, its propellers slicing the air, marks both the beginning and the turning point of Shelter, the opera I wrote with composer Juliet Palmer. To quote Juliet, "the plane in the opera transports us into the imaginary realm of history intermingled with allegory, a cartoon plane reminding us that this is not real, but that in singing the plane into being, any one of us can become the plane. None of us are bystanders." As the engine subsides, the pilot climbs out and follows the desert road. In his hand is the musical instrument of the post-atomic age, the Geiger counter. Mounted on the dashboard, the instrument plays a starring role in videos of illicit drives through the Fukushima dead zone. It authenticates danger for tourists wandering the abundant greenery of Chernobyl. It verifies history in the desert of Alamogordo. Geiger counter in hand, the pilot listens for a spasm of clicking, like a cicada's mating call. The instrument unleashes a flurry of rat-a-tats as the pilot approaches the nuclear family home.
Ten, comments overheard at Camera Atomica on a Sunday afternoon in August. A grandmother, presumably, with her granddaughter as they exit the exhibition. "I remember this," she says. "What?" asks the young girl. "The bomb," she said. "Oh, was that here?" 11.
Oh.
Thank you very much. I will say, this was a wee gift for John. I want to introduce Peter McGillivray and Andrea Ludwig, who are amongst Canada's most cherished opera singers, in Shelter, which, believe it or not, is actually a cartoon comedic opera. Andrea played Lisa Meitner, the physicist, who in the story is the midwife and governess to the child of a couple, Thomas and Claire, and Peter played Thomas, the father obsessed with keeping his child safe from the world, and the child is radioactive. Her name is Hope, and that's the story of which they helped us participate.
Yeah, it's more than that. I thought it was more like 15. Were you saying 18?
Okay,
yeah. Yeah. Almost every 2 years, sometimes every year, since 1994.
But it is an interesting, I mean, it's such a great project, but it is an interesting kind of, just open-ended question in that change continues.
Yeah.
The growth of the environment continues, and you know, it's a kind of witnessing project that keeps going back to see what has changed again, and it will always be changing. So it's.
Yeah, we were talking about this earlier. The question of when might David stop going back, and as far as we've discussed, he and I, he'll keep going until he stops being interested in going. That's sort of his answer at this point. And what I think is important to know about his work, which I didn't really talk about, is that he has thousands of images that he's never printed, never shown. And his work has been shown, here and there, and it's in John's show, and recently it was shown at the National Gallery, but often it's a series of similar images that he selected, as images that he likes to show, but there are thousands of them that are in this database, basically, that he creates. And he doesn't have a big coffee table book, and he just worked away at this project, sort of uncaring as far as whether people were interested or not, in a way. I'll end there. Unless you want to add something to that, Blake. Sure.
I was just really struck by what you said about stories changing the brain and your repeated references to emotional coolness. And once you related that to the exhibit space. I'm just wondering about your decision to omit images and to do this very performative, affective kind of storytelling and to select song to accompany that. And I just wonder if you could say a little bit about affect, and maybe is it the oversaturation of images that led you to make that decision? And do we need that kind of connective storying of images?
Well,
was that your decision?
It's interesting because in a sense it's a kind of accidental choice, because Peter and I don't usually use images. I'm here really as a writer, not a photographer, although of course the question of the theater and the performative comes up always. So it wasn't, we were more noticing, this is an interesting phenomenon to be in a situation where always there are images, and although of course usually any conference I go, I'm usually the only one that doesn't have PowerPoint. So Peter can speak to it too, but for me it is a choice to be with language and bodies and remember what that's like. The question of sound is also, I just really wanted them to come. And it wasn't really more than, let's give John the taste of this. And they were so generous to agree to come and do it. So I have to think through what that then means. It's really interesting to think through what it then means. I've had the experience in the last year or two of starting to work with psychologists who do a lot of brain science. And it was really, and it's the most rudimentary entry into it that's possible, but my understanding that if I spend an hour with you and you are listening to me and engaging with me, and I've watched videos of, or, you know, footage of small children doing this with psychologists, that not only do you feel a little better because you were listened to, but your brain, you know, you guys probably know more about this than I do, but your brain actually is changed by that experience. So I think we're all storying all the time. This all yesterday was story, and story includes images and language, different languages. But I think it's very interesting that this stuff about the brain is actually suggesting that there's more biophysicality to hope than maybe we thought. So I'm not sure what kind of response that is for you, but.
Anything important to add, apart from to say that it seems to me that in this context here of what we were doing specifically today is that song is much more continuous with story in this sense, and an image in this for us here would have amounted to some kind of an instruction, right? And which was precisely what we didn't kind of want to do. But yeah, that's.
Thank you for this wonderful performance, Julia and Peter, and thank you, Carla, for your presentation. First, also very insightful. Question for Carla, and then a million questions for Peter and Julia, but I'll have to reduce the million to one. Carla, number one, you showed pictures of David McMillan's book because it's repeated photography, right? So I would like to know how you frame or what is your, how do you think about the nuclear uncanny in those photographs? You mentioned repeatedly the haunting quality of these pictures, but is it only haunting? And how do you define the nuclear image? What is your approach to the nuclear image? It's a difficult question. Because nuclear uncanny designates, of course, Joseph as the one who invented it, but it designates a lot of things. So how do you place those photos in the context of nuclear uncanny? What is the nuclear uncanny for you and nuclear image? And questions for, I would have a million, but I said it was a wonderful performance. I would like
Carla answer the question.
Yeah, and shall I ask the question?
And then if somebody else wants to ask, we'll have another question.
So I'll be very brief. Agnosia about Peter and Julia. Agnosia in the context of Fukushima, what is being forgotten in Fukushima? Is it Japan's own nuclear history? What other amnesias are there? And what is it the topicness and the hexatus, this is thisness. So what did the topistics of your travel, of your being in Fukushima, animate for you, or reactivate for you, or made it more effective?
Okay, sure. I'm going to answer that question a little bit by sidestepping it, and talk about my experience of writing this paper. You know, how informed it was by what had happened at Fukushima. So I guess the reason I point to that is that for me there's such a strong haunting in this paper of the events that most recently happened. And my responses to Fukushima were so strongly informed by the work that I was doing on environmentalism and photography while working on my dissertation, and questions about how images communicate to audiences, to how nuclear images communicate to audiences today. So for me, a nuclear image is as much an image about climate change as it is about a person's individual response to nature, I guess. So that's certainly the feeling I have today, and David McMillan's images are just fit in so beautifully with this sense I have of how our shifting kind of environmental consciousness or unconsciousness has become concerned not just with nuclear or not just with disaster.
Peter,
who wants the mic?
Olivia's question.
There's just my hand, so I wondered if you wanted.
Oh, why don't you, if you've got anything to say to Olivia's question, go ahead. Otherwise, we'll take some more questions.
The immediate answer when you ask what registered for us is what we just read, really, right? And I think we could probably keep going for a long time. We have so much material, you know how it is with this sort of experience, right? So that's I don't mean to be kind of coy, but that is kind of my first response, is these are the pieces that we're starting to register. In terms of what is erased, or what, you know, what is the inability to see or register, that's going to be so different for everyone's relationship with anything and with the event. And for me, it really is our friend Aya's comment, everyone comes for the trauma. So the erasures that I'm interested in all of this work are agency, beauty, hopefulness, resilience, without being Disneyland about it. You know, how do we hold these things together at the same time? And I was also, because I brought it up in reference to the Dene, I am very interested in trying to understand Peter and I, for example, who've been all over the bloody planet but haven't been to Port Hope, which is right next door. At least not really been. So we were talking about this and saying, well, why? So when we were trying to understand, you know, the Dene not being in the exhibit, really, I think it's a really complicated, interesting question that's not about the exhibit at all, or any particular political moment for anybody in making decisions, but it's a much larger question of what do we see and not see, and how do we even understand whether we have the ability to see what we don't see.
Yes, I'd like to ask Carla about David McMillan's work. I haven't yet seen the art exhibition, which I will do, but does David also provide any text that goes with the images? Because I was really intrigued about the stories behind the images. For example, with Sergei, why is he holding those mushrooms and what is he going to do with them? I mean, I was just
going to eat them.
Really, but are they not contaminated? So I mean, there are stories there that are
actually no. David doesn't really provide.
Oh my gosh.
Much context. You know, as a photographer, I don't want to speak for him, but I would say that I think he sees the images speaking for itself, and his titles provide information, and that's as much as he wishes to provide. And that's a conceptual decision that he makes. You can visit his website, and he does have some maps and more information, where he sort of has an artist statement. But he's a very kind of formal photographer. He's drawn to the image-making process. And Chernobyl, for him, is very much, his response to Chernobyl is driven by his experience of seeing it.
First of all, I don't agree that you didn't have any images in your presentation. It was loaded with images. So much for that. Peter, you promised to deliver something about, or you asked out loud, what are the roots that join Fukushima with Hiroshima? If you gave the answer to that, I didn't get it, but maybe you just alluded to it. But could I just propose what I think joins those two and Chernobyl is the presence of the unearthly energy of annihilation. And that's why the Chernobyl pictures aren't simply pictures of nature coming back after catastrophe. It's like it's over when you have that annihilation occur that doesn't ever occur on Earth until the atomic age. So there's something really profoundly attractive, mysterious, and dark about that. This is where that annihilation occurred, and oh, look, there's other things sort of coming back, but it's, could that be the root, Peter?
I would say to you that it's entirely earthly. You know, that is not about unearthliness. And I think that's kind of a theme that winds its way through what we were doing here, is we're trying to kind of think about this. I mean, this from my point of view, this writing began with an idea that I would like to develop, which isn't at all here really, that every image emerges from the ground in one way or another. And I think so we're talking here about the ground, whether we're talking about falling in a well or trying not to, vis-a-vis the predicament of theory, or thinking about the status of the ground or our relation to it, is like these are incredibly earthly things that we're dealing with. So it is, you know, to reframe that question, I would say, you know, if there's, it's an earthliness, in some sense, it is really an earthliness that connects Hiroshima, Fukushima, and Chernobyl, and, right? It's, you know, it comes back to the thing that we talked about, you know, early in the summer about, you know, this, the kind of the myth that, you know, plutonium wasn't part of the planet, that it was somehow an invention that comes after the fact, right? Does that kind of get anywhere near toward answering?
No.
Perfect. Julie?
There's a question here, right? Jamie?
Oh, okay.
No. Oh, it was you. I'm sorry. Kathy. Or Katie McCormick. Right. Forgive me, Katie. I'm going blind.
Okay. Thank you. I was interested in I think Julie said, in relation to Fukushima, Hiroshima became safe. It's that notion of safe. And in both reflections, the recuperation of these places of, you know, sort of original disaster. It's like the baptism by fire of Hiroshima, you know, the birth. I mean, of course, after, you know, Trinity, but the way in which it's recuperated and come back and become beautiful, and that each of these monuments encapsulates some memory, but that now it's thriving, it's alive. And with Chernobyl, again, David's visit and, you know, revisiting reminds us again and again, this place is alive. So it's just interesting, and wanted you to maybe just comment on that terrible paradox of these places of original destruction, which almost become, and dare I say it, nostalgic now, that they're almost precious. And I say that in a kind of uncomfortable way,
yeah.
Because I struggle with it in my own photography of Hiroshima, which is beautiful.
Oh, yeah. I just realized, I've seen your photography. Yeah, you presented at Ryerson a few months ago. Yeah, okay. So, hello. I'm really struck by the language that we are stuck with, perhaps not stuck with, but so when Blake asked the question, why does David keep going back? I was thinking back, it's such an interesting word. You know, Hiroshima has gone back to being beautiful. And yet, every time David visits Chernobyl, something's going forward. So isn't he going forward over and over? And I think what matters to me to try to hold in some experiential way and some, you know, thinking way is that Hiroshima always was beautiful and terrible. Not to the extent, the catastrophic extent that Bob's reminding us of, but when Aya says everyone comes for the trauma, it's not that the trauma's over, it's that there's this vibrant life in Fukushima City, for example. Restaurants are full of people. Every day you have to read about which vegetables it's okay to eat or okay to eat. So it's the somehow the conjuncture of all of it together, which is maybe a little bit about this thing of us all living together in this, you know, what James was talking about. I don't know, yesterday I've been thinking about it ever since, living inside this big computerized internet thing. So here we are nevertheless together, you know, struggling to have some sort of foolish contact with each other and some continuing to grow and nurture. And I don't know if I'm answering you at all, Katie, but to me, it is a fight against nostalgia, absolutely. The sort of sentimentalizing of tragedy is one of the things I hate and sort of try to make sure I'm not doing, but then I'm inevitably going to do it because it's also reception, right? But maybe that's enough. But I think the thing of what it is to go back, it's not restored. And I think of Keo yesterday talking about consolation. You know, maybe it's not about consolation. Maybe it's something else.
There's a question up there. The mic is coming. And we'll have time for one more after this before we take a coffee break.
Okay. Thanks, everybody. This has been so enjoyable. Carla, I have a question for you about this parallel that you're drawing between imaging Chernobyl and imagining anthropogenic climate change. Mm-hmm. The romance of imaging the world without people is really seductive. And I'm wondering how you see this as hopeful, because you talked about a dark hopefulness, but that certainly would allude to a hopefulness for nature taking over after the violence of people being annihilated. So I worry about that parallel. Mm. And couldn't this also be an excuse for sort of perpetuating or this dithering that's going on as far as addressing climate change, if we're sort of take heart, you know, the environment can do this, it can be beautiful again in this way, even though we can't see how toxic it is and all this other stuff. So I just wondering if you could respond to that.
What I did here was an exercise in personal reception, right? So what I was trying to do was really draw all the different responses that I feel in David's work. So one of them being this tension between my feeling of hopelessness in humanity, right? That maybe we should just clear off and let the land recover. And then, of course, my feeling of personal responsibility as a human to humanity. And I think that it's important to acknowledge that David's work brings those up, both those issues up. So I hope I wasn't endorsing a kind of radical environmentalist stance, while at the same time acknowledging that I think that's a feeling people will have in looking at this work. As far as your second comment, I hope that by bringing up Nancy's kind of provocative notion of being in the present and being present, I could sort of evoke the necessary work that we do need to do today, which is to take responsibility for today as far as any kind of imagining of the future. To imagine a future without understanding the present role in the future is impossible. So I hope that this exercise that I engaged in kind of drawing out the environmental imaginary helped people to think about the various different types of responses at play without necessarily endorsing one or the other. But we could talk more later.
This gives me an opportunity to say this is Susan Chupley, who is the next speaker. And the reason we've gone on a little bit longer here is that there's just going to be one speaker, and that will be Susan, after the break. And then we'll break for lunch. So that's why I extended this for an extra 15 minutes. Those who are looking at the time schedule. Susan Chupley, please.
Oh. Thanks, John. I just wanted to follow up on this sort of train of questioning because I was reading various reports on the forest at Fukushima and also at Chernobyl, and in some way, when I think those images of kind of regenerative growth of nature, it's a false image because it's a radically different kind of forest that has developed in subsequent to 1986. So it isn't the return of the real in any sense of that. Imaginary, and I was really struck when I was in the Fukushima Daiichi Prefecture at the kind of relentless attempts to kind of re-engineer natural ecosystems in terms of removal of topsoil in the Itati Valley, etc. So I guess my question is a bridge between the two presentations around trees, and when Peter mentioned the trees that had been reoriented and therefore their kind of role as witness had been, you said realigned, I believe is the word that you kind of used. And in some way, that realignment for me is actually kind of not so much a transgression, but a kind of testimonial to the kind of radical realignment that is actually happening and is registered by natural systems. And so that we actually have to encounter those, something like a tree, as an entirely different kind of natural species, and we can't naturalize that in any sense of the word. So it's a bit of a comment that tries to bridge the two presentations. And I don't know if either of you has anything you'd like to add to that.
You go first.
Okay.
Because Carla,
yes.
All right, that's my turn. I guess it also links in a way to the kind of agnosia. And where these kinds of just like you, as traveling in Fukushima, you're kind of always navigating these sort of culturally ratified false memories, right? In such a way as you're trying to figure out sort of what's going on, and this the production of doubt, as we were thinking about yesterday, and I think the trees then become subject to the same kind of thing, right? In terms of what their capacity is as you know, natural subjects, I guess. And this is kind of what the master gardener was saying, which was, you know, it's like, you gotta be careful, you don't wanna help them too much. You know, only according to what their capacities are. So there is a very funny thing going on there with thinking about trees and thinking about natural systems and what restoration might come to mean in that context, when in fact you can't restore anything. All you can do is move shit around to somewhere where it happens to be, you know, slightly less inconvenient to have. The reproduction of these natural systems is a very interesting thing that's going on there. Do you want to like talk about Chernobyl? Do you want to? How'd you do that?
Either of you want to make a comment as well on this? Or is that closing door a sign?
I think the door just closed.
This has been an extraordinary session. I'd just like to thank all three of you enormously. And thank you. Is my favorite duet from the opera, Bravo.